very happy to introduce Michael Billington from The Guardian and Glenda Jackson on my left. We're very pleased to be here. We've enjoyed talking about this question that we've been posed, and we hope that you're going to enjoy talking about it with us. We're not going to make this, in any sense, a sort of conversation up here with the audience listening. We are very keen to take questions or comments at any point, so as soon as you feel moved to speak, do please wave at me, and I'm going to do my best to make sure that I bring anybody who wants to make a point in. But we have got mics in the room, and because the acoustics in here aren't perfect, unless you're using a mic, you are going to have to do that thing of waiting for the mic to get to you. So this is a great topic, whether and in what way Shakespeare is always political. I mean, when I saw it, I thought there's a very short answer to that question, which is yes. But that would make for a very short session, and in academic life, we always have to show our workings and give reasons for our answers, and of course there's also an immensely long answer to this question, which takes in all the many different political contexts of productions and readings of Shakespeare's drama, and all the many ways that the idea of politics changes from the circulation of sovereignty, which is of course central to many of the plays, to ideas of class conflict and the sex war, and whether we're going to live under monarchies or republics, and whether there is any space for democracy or some early idea of democracy in Shakespeare's work. So those are the sorts of questions we're going to be considering. I'm going to begin, I think, by asking both Glenda Jackson and Michael Billington to talk about the way in which the political nature of Shakespeare's plays in production varies from context to context. And I wonder, Michael Billington, whether you'd be able to begin with that, because You've seen more Shakespeare than most people in this room.
It's a big question.
But you've seen more Shakespeare than anybody alive, probably.
I wouldn't go as far as to say that. What happens with Shakespeare plays, it's they change constantly. They're not fixed entities. That's the first and most obvious thing to say. And you can take almost any Shakespeare play, and I find its meaning and its emphases and its political content changes from one era to another, one place to another. I mean, should I take the most obvious example of all? So this is Hamlet, you know, the most central play in the canon in many ways, so Benda might say King Lear is. But I mean, Hamlet, I've spent my life, you know, 50 years of my life watching different productions of Hamlet, and it is never the same play twice. Mm-hmm. And one of the most striking things is, depending on the geographical or historical context in which you see it, I mean, for example, a famous production, I remember, by the Taganka Theatre in Russia, in Moscow, by a man called Abimov, dominated by the image of a vast mobile curtain, a vast woolen curtain. Mm. And this curtain would sweep downstage, upstage, across the stage. Characters were always being glimpsed behind this curtain. You would see hands going through it. At one point, I remember, it came forward and swept Ophelia into her grave. I mean, the whole point of the curtain as a metaphor was to symbolise an oppressive, tyrannical society based on surveillance. And I know that production actually did come to England. There was an English version of it in Leicester. It didn't have anything like the same resonance, because whatever our society is like, it's not quite as obsessively based on surveillance as the Soviet Union. That's just one example. Another very quick example, I remember a wonderful production of Hamlet came from Romania during the Ceausescu era, and it was based on the image of Elsinore as some kind of dusty museum. Everything seemed cobwebbed and antiquated. A piano tinkled vaguely in the background. And it was the perfect image of a tyranny, you know, that had gone stale. And apparently when it played in Romania, the young people flocked to this production. It was their way of protesting against the Ceausescu regime. I mean, I could go on, and I won't, but, you know, that's a classic example of a play that shifts its ground and its meaning. And it does, too, in England. I think in Britain now, we're much more interested in Elsinore, or as interested in Elsinore, the place, as we are in Hamlet, the character. And I've noticed successive British productions are now emphasising this element of spying, eavesdropping, espionage. When Nick Heitner did it at the National a few years ago, that was very much an oppressive society based on close surveillance.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is these plays change from moment to moment, country to country.
Yes, and presumably, Glenda Jackson, from director to director and actor to actor. Can you say a bit about that process by which the play is interpreted in production?
Well, I haven't really done that many to be able to make categoric comparisons with directors. My rule of thumb is that all good directors know what they don't want, and all bad directors always know what they do. So as an actor, if you've got one of the ones who aren't any good, you're trying to replicate something that is running in their mind already. And with Shakespeare, that can be almost impossible to break through, because certainly in this country, and I found it very interesting, the two examples that you gave, really of the kind of production that was overtly highlighting, made central, the political situations in their own countries, which were absolute cruel dictators, and they were allowed to go on. I mean, I just found that fascinating. I mean, did the bosses not realise?
You can't stop Hamlet, can you? You can't censor
Hamlet. Well, yes, people can be censored, and certainly in Shakespeare's time, there was very strong censorship, wasn't it? There was the fear of being censored. But to get back to your question, it's really... In one way, I think in this country, we are burdened by the weight of Shakespeare. And certainly as actors, if we are foolish enough to read the footnotes and the explanations of what certain things mean and received information that can be taken back for decades, you are completely and utterly lost. What you have to come, well, what you say have to is absurd. But the process of rehearsing Shakespeare is to actually find the moment. You have to be, as you do with every play actually, but it's tougher with him because he's so much better than everybody else, so you know you're on a hiding to nothing when you start. I mean, you know, the really good directors say, right, we're going to try and get to the top of this Everest, and we're not going to get there, but we're all going to try. And that's fair enough, that is what everybody does try to do. But you can be burdened with this terrible, terrible weight of this incredible dramatist and forget that his bottom line was he wrote plays to entertain. That's the bottom line. That's what it's about.
That's so true.
Don't get carried away, I've got more. And we can, it can be totally forgotten, and I have in my time, touch wood, I haven't been in that many productions, but I mean, I have seen productions in which actually the play was completely and utterly buried because people were so burdened with what people had told them it was all about.
Right, and yet there is always a design, you know, as Michael pointed out, you've always got a set, and the set will inevitably depict some kind of city or wilderness or country.
Well, up to a point, that's true. Okay. I did a production of a Scottish play in America, and I arrived for rehearsal, and there was the set, and there were the drawings of the costumes. Now, the costumes would have been more applicable to some kind of, I don't know, romanticised... Well, I was going to say romanticised Robin Hood. You can't have a more romantic thing than Robin Hood. I mean, it bore no relation whatsoever to the play that we were about to do. And the set was just bare. I mean, there was a small kind of space at the front, and then it rose backwards. So it was absolutely impossible to stand actually facing the people you were trying to talk to, unless you were kind of like this. So that was of no use at all. And God, I mean, God, how much it cost to destroy it. Well, that's how much it cost to make it, I've no idea, but it went. And eventually we were restored to a pretty much, you know, a flat area and the odd flag being brought in. But
was there a heated discussion about that with
like
the designer and the and the director and the actors?
Oh, with the actors.
With the actors.
Than I think with the director, because I mean the system then in America was quite different. Everybody was sort of. I'd been used to working in companies, so I was very surprised that nobody in the company had ever usually worked with each other before, or that kind of thing. So that was very, very strange. But having said that, of what was disastrous, then you think of the set that Sally Jacobs did for Brooks, A Midsummer Night's Dream. I mean, you know, it's just, she says it was a white box, but it was a damn sight more than a white box with what they could do in it.
The point that Michael made about Ceausescu's Romania and the way that going to the theatre has different meanings for audiences, different kinds of audiences and audiences at different times is an interesting one because, and clearly everybody in the audience isn't exactly identical. For some audience members, there might be pure entertainment. For lots of audience members, presumably in Shakespeare's own time, they were recognising the allusions and the jokes and the puns and the ways in which comment was being passed on the crown and the government and the question of censorship and so forth, obviously.
Well, that's good thing, isn't it? I mean, any audience is composed of obviously different levels of experience, knowledge, etc. And in Shakespeare production, you're going to find people seeing it for the first time and others who've been,
who've
seen it. No, for the 40th time. It has to appeal to each audience on its own level.
But undoubtedly, in some settings, going to the theatre is more like, for us, going on a demonstration. So in Prague,
that was what I was trying to make. I mean, the theatre in those countries, in those eras, you know, the Soviet era, the theatre became almost the only form of protest, you know. And I remember the Taganka, keep on this bit of the Taganka, which I went to several times. Crowds would gather in Taganka Square in Moscow long before the performance started. Merely to have a ticket for a show, you know, was an extraordinary event. And the clamour to get into it was enormous because that was the only way at that time.
Yeah.
I think this was Brezhnev's Russia. People had a registering and protest. I mean, theatre, you know, fulfills different functions in different societies. And the problem in the post-communist societies has been finding out what theatre is actually for, because in Czechoslovakia, in the Soviet Union, in all those countries, theatre was the vehicle of protest. Yeah. Then, once there was a liberal regime, they had to discover what theatre was actually about.
Right, and how do you think that, how is that question being resolved as far as you understand?
Well, I'm not up to date on all those countries. No. I know in Czechoslovakia they had serious problems in discovering a new aesthetic. Because if theatre wasn't there to help topple a regime, then what actually was it for? We go to the theatre, you know, for all sorts of reasons, don't we? Prestige, entertainment, you know, to pass the time, etc.
But it's interesting that, because I had a conversation with Barbara Brecht after the war had come down, and we've been trying to arrange for some time permission, they still have the rights from the family to do Mother Courage. And I said to her how they had closed down, because the Brecht estate had been very, I mean, well maintained during the kind of communist reign and very well funded, you know, well protected. All that had gone. And I said to her, well, you know, what's happening now? Oh, I said, what are people seeing? Oh, she said, they're all watching television and they've all got discs on the side of their building. You think all those decades of, you know, wreck to change the aesthetic. Bang, it's over in a flash.
So Shakespeare's plays are often about really explicitly political themes. So who's going to wear the crown next? Who rules?
Right.
How is it decided who rules?
Right.
You know, what happens to people who challenge rule? Now, in some ways, those questions are just perennial questions that never change. In other ways, of course, the context in which we read this circulation of power or circulation of sovereignty changes massively. And I was wondering if either of you could speak a bit about the ways in which that process is depicted changes with Shakespearean production, especially in relationship to, you know, current affairs and the current genres of political comment.
Well, my big argument at the moment, or contention, is it's certain types of Shakespeare play that mean most to us. My argument is it's the history. Shakespeare's history plays, I think, absolutely central. I was brought up in that sort of tradition that there were these four great tragedies. They were the absolute peak, weren't they? You know? And then there were these things called comedies, which were slightly, you know, on a low level. And then the histories, which were of interest only to a certain minority. But just look around you now. I mean, what's BBC Television done recently? The Hollow Crown, with enormous acclaim and success. What opened last week in London? Richard III with Ralph Fiennes. What's opening two nights' time? Michelle Terry playing Henry V in the Park. Everywhere I look, Shakespeare's histories are being done. And I had an astonishing weekend in Chicago about a month ago. In Chicago, they've got a very good Shakespeare theatre there. They're doing their version of Shakespeare's histories called Tug of War, adapted and rewritten. An extraordinary apposite to an American audience who are obviously hungry to see these plays about medieval monarchs. Mm-hmm. And one has to ask why this is. And it seems to me it's because Shakespeare's history plays deal with all the issues which we are obsessed with today. I mean, what is the nature of good government? Mm. How do you hold together a kingdom that is in danger of fracturing and falling to pieces? Mm. What do you do with a bad ruler? You know, what is the instrument for getting rid of someone who is an inefficient or tyrannical ruler, etc.? I was thinking a moment ago, earlier today actually, about this. I mean, given the sort of toxic rhetoric, you know, we've endured over the last few weeks in the referendum debate, there's an amazing line in Henry VI when Margaret of Anjou, she's not yet queen, she comes to England to marry Henry VI. And I remember she has a line when she looks at this wrangling cabinet or this wrangling assembly of the British elite and says, "Is this the governance of British Isles?" I think God could ask that question now. So what I'm saying in a roundabout way is that I think Shakespeare's histories are absolutely central. And to me personally, I think much as I love the comedies and much as I respect the tragedies, I get more out of the history plays at this moment. And it's wonderful to live through a time and plays like Henry VI, you know, long despised as mere juvenilia, are now being performed and enjoyed.
Yes.
I know that answers your question, but my argument is we find in these plays issues that have not gone away, perennial issues, that we're still debating them.
Yes. I mean, yes, that which is incredibly interesting, and thank you very much. One of the things that I've been thinking about is how difficult it is to represent politics. We're not very good at it. We have news programmes and we have talking heads, and every now and again we get something spectacular. Although it's not that spectacular, like, you know, the fall of a government or, of course, a revolution.
You mean a general election?
And a general election.
I mean, that's something you should be proud of we have in this country. Anyway, sorry to
interrupt. I am very proud of it. We have difficulty in representing it in visually. It's quite hard for people to sort of grasp what's going on. And obviously one thing that's happened in Shakespeare is that you have monarchs parading around with crowns on their heads and velvet coats.
But this Prime Minister's question started with one of the minutes, watch items of the week on television. I thought that was highly visual. Whether we think of it in the content, it's highly visual, isn't it?
Yes, it certainly is. It certainly is. And one of the ways that this problem, though, of how to represent political power has got around, not only by the costumes, but it is also by that showing the difference between the office and the person.
Yes.
The frail human being, as opposed to the trappings of power. More often recently, or in the 20th century perhaps, it seemed to me that we go straight for the frailty of the man, and there's less in the way of crowns and scepters and capes and cloaks and so on. So I was wondering if you...
Well, I don't know. I mean,
Has it not changed as much as I...
I thought Glenda thinks. I mean, my image of Shakespeare's history plays, particularly on stage, is how visually exciting they are, actually, right, and how often directors find metaphors and ways of dealing with it. A classic example, which comes to my mind, I think one of the great, great Shakespeare production of my lifetime was a production of Richard II, which John Barton did for the RSC, when he had two actors, Ian Richardson and Richard Pascoe, alternating, remember this,
yes,
night by night, as Richard and Bolingbroke. A, that made a superb point that Richard and Bolingbroke are not opposites, they are two sides of the same coin.
Yeah.
But if I remember correctly, that production began with the two actors sort of walking downstage and looking at each other and sort of handing. One, I think, picks up the crown and hands it to the other, as if to say, tonight, you're Richard. Tonight, I'm Bolingbroke, you know. And it, so you've got there, instantly, the metaphor of kingship as a role that you play.
Yes.
You've got also, I think, the fact that, you know, these are human beings behind the crown. I mean, I thought that was an extraordinarily potent visual image, if you like, about the nature of power. And John Barton followed it through with great consistency.
Yes.
So, I mean, I could repeat examples, but I think down the ages, directors and designers have found ways of embodying history on stage.
Yes. And, of course, there's the theatricality of politics as well as, as it were, the way in which politics is represented in theatre.
You say that, and when I was first elected, people said to me, you simply exchanged one form of theatre for another.
Okay.
And I said, well, if that's the case, Parliament is markedly under-rehearsed. The lighting is awful, and the acoustic is even worse, which at that time was true. But there is that element within it, which one has to acknowledge, in as much as... I mean, I'm very dubious about parts of what we're talking about here. I mean, I would like us to be able to define politics and political rather more cogently, I think, than we have to date. In as much as the big thing that's always missing for me in the Shakespearean canon is an electorate. There is no electorate. I mean, there are peasants, there are people, you know, there are people rioting in revolution, all that kind of thing. But the transposition of what was the political world in Shakespeare's day to what is the political world in our day, I think, is a very, very hard bridge to cross. And that's why I think the symbols that you talk about are very, very important today. They may not necessarily enlighten us anymore as to what our political landscape is, but clearly, as far as, oh, I was going to say deluding us, but that would be too harsh a word, in breaking down that, to me, mythical barrier, you know, that Shakespeare is incomprehensible if it isn't relevant. And I just find that, I don't understand where that comes from at all. I've sort of lost track of what I was trying to say. Well,
so one of the thoughts is that actually politics isn't as theatrical as all of that, and that we have to bear in mind the distance between Shakespeare's politics and our own. And yet there is the question then why we have this constant reinvention of the politics of Shakespeare, constant reinventions of ways of representing political processes, and Shakespeare seems to be a brilliant vehicle for doing it.
Well, it's Shakespeare, I mean, yes, obviously you're right, there is no electorate, you know, the process of electing governments, all that has changed, but Shakespeare understands extraordinarily well the insinuating nature of power, the seduction
absolutely.
Of power, the operation of power. I mean, I was saying to you, before we start this discussion, actually, I mean, the transfer of power, which King Lear is about, isn't it, really? You know, I've seen that so often in today's world, actually. Someone who, having got power, is incapable of is passing it on, handing it over. It seems the hardest thing in the world. I've never had that kind of power, I don't know, but to dissolve power, get rid of power, is incredibly difficult. But just talking about character for a moment, I mean, Shakespeare's understanding of political character is so astute. Now, Julius Caesar's a play that I think has come to life again in recent years in new ways. And why is that? It's because we no longer take the stereotypical view that it's about, you know, Brutus, the noblest Roman of them all, and, you know, involved in this conspiracy, and Mark Antony is the showman, and Cassius is the devious thinker, blah, blah, blah. No, what Shakespeare understood with astonishing clarity is the fallibility of the self-important liberal. Brutus is the archetypal grandiose liberal who thinks he's right about every single topic, he's wrong about every single decision he makes in the play. He says, no, no, we must only murder Caesar, we mustn't murder anyone else, no, wrong, you know. They say, we mustn't let Mark Antony speak. Oh, no, he says, we must let Mark Antony speak, you know. He makes about six decisions in that play that are absolutely fatal. And I think that's Shakespeare's understanding of the woolly idealist in a world of realpolitik. Mm-hmm. So although a lot of the systems of politics have changed, Shakespeare's understanding of, I don't know, the motivations of politics remain perennial.
Yeah, but, I mean, the point is that realpolitik is inhabited by real people. Mm. Now, they may cease to look like real people if the realpolitik is sufficiently extreme either side of what we're told is the political spectrum, but they are still essentially human beings with the innate fallibilities, which is one of the greatest things about Shakespeare. He's completely non-judgmental.
Yes.
He doesn't write good people, he doesn't write bad people, he writes people. And it is the circumstances, nine times out of ten, if we're talking about the kind of political spectrum, which are bringing those hidden things that we've all got in us to the surface. So that, you know, Brutus says, no, no, we can't have Mark Antony, even though there are people saying to him, who up until that point he's respected and regarded as knowing what they're talking about, saying, don't be mad, you know, you can't live. But Shakespeare never says that. I mean, that's... He simply writes about how people are.
We can deduce that.
Extreme circumstances.
Yes.
You know.
Yes.
He also sees the politics in the everyday, though. I mean, that there's a danger, obviously, of being anachronistic here. But there are power struggles in all kinds of contexts.
Oh, yes.
Between parents and children, you know, between generations, between social groups, between classes, between men and women, and especially daughters and fathers and so on. And it does seem that although we must beware of anachronism, Shakespeare really looks at power and authority and how they circulate between real people. And that's one of the ways in which his particular perspective on politics makes him perennially interesting to modern audiences.
Well, yes, I mean, I keep going back to this point. I mean, he understands the operation of character, as Clifford says. Take a play we haven't mentioned yet, Measure for Measure. Why is that play so often revived today? Because it's about power, isn't it? It's about a man who abuses power, Angela. He's given power. There's a wonderful line that play about a man dressed in a little brief authority. Mm. And that is Angelo, isn't it? He's the deputy who suddenly is given power. What does he do when he's got power? He finds himself attracted to this novitiate, Isabella, and then uses his power to wield sexual authority over her. I mean, it's a brilliant demonstration of the corrupting nature of power.
Yeah.
And you can take that play and then transpose it to almost any situation. You know, you can make it about American presidents, you know, abusing their office, etc.
Absolutely.
Shakespeare,
put it down anywhere.
Creates, I don't know, these extraordinary contests, power battles, which are translatable to almost any situation, I would argue.
Yeah. I just want to pause and see if anybody from the audience does want to make a remark or ask a question about power and authority. We're going to go on to some different... There's a gentleman in the front row here. Your mic is on its way. It's nearly here.
Would Shakespeare vote next Thursday?
Ah. I didn't expect that one to come up the first one.
I think that's an extremely good question.
Go on, you go first.
Well, I can't answer that in any context other than my own proclivity and what I have already. I have already voted. I have a postal vote. And I have said, and I'm sure there will be people who will find this both, well, low level, but if we vote to leave, do we not simply become another little Channel Island? And are we not better than that? I think we are. I think we have. But for me, the really killing thing is this argument that if we stay within Europe, it's going to be an ever closer union and I love this idea of the sovereignty that we have lost. I'm a subject of the United Kingdom. I'm a citizen of the European Union, but put that to one side. The future is some form of alienation, isolation, banging a big drum saying, we're better than any of the rest of you, we'll work with you if we like you, but if we don't, we're not going to. And that's the way the world is going to develop in the future. When you look at a world in which the fractures that have already taken place, the horrors that are being visited upon people like us in other parts of the world are not just daily, but almost hourly. And you think, surely the way the world has to go is an ever closer union with all the nations of the world, not saying, no, no, we don't want anything more to do with you. That's
and yet Shakespeare has so often been read as the champion of, you know,
well, you can you can take speeches and isolate
it. Sceptred pile.
But I would argue the man who sets his ways in where Venice, Verona, yeah. Vienna, was a passionate European, actually. Yeah. Right. Yeah. It would be
I also think Shakespeare would vote, right? He was a very, very canny political commentator. He knew what was, he knew his onions. I mean, of course, you know, Glenda Jackson is right that he was there to write plays to entertain, but he was an exceptionally astute commentator. There's another question here in the second row, and then we'll move on.
A comment. Didn't Shakespeare suggest a division, like dividing a kingdom, like in King Lear, was possibly a recipe for dissension and more trouble. And so dividing things up was probably not a good idea in that regard.
Absolutely right.
Yes, because that was the prevailing at the time that he wrote it. I mean, Elizabeth was gone. I mean, we've got the Stuarts back and that idea of there being a division which had been there. But his play is based on the earlier play, the tragedy of King Lear and his daughters. And like many great colleagues in the theatre have said to me, never be afraid to steal as long as you steal from the best. Which I think Shakespeare probably had heard from somebody. But what's really interesting about that is that if we're thinking about King Lear, he divides the kingdom, but it doesn't really occur to him that he no longer has power, and he behaves as though he does, and it's pretty stormy because of that.
I do agree that his plots often tell the story of the division of sovereignty as bringing disaster in its wake, but equally he's very clear that sovereignty has to be shared, can't be held on to. His monarchs are very fragile.
They're very pragmatic though, aren't they, actually? Contemporary echoes again. I mean, one of the points of the productions I saw in Chicago, I mentioned earlier, Tug of War, was how often in Shakespeare's plays, leaders invent a foreign war in order to distract the trouble.
Yes.
What's that line about busy, giddy minds with foreign quarrels is the line, isn't it? In other words, if you've got trouble at home, if the Scots are being difficult, which in Shakespeare they are, then you find a war abroad to ease your conscience. How many leaders ask the question that Henry V asked, can I with right and conscience make this claim, etc. So what I'm saying is, yes, Shakespeare understands, we've talked a lot about Shakespeare understanding the press of power. He understands, I think, the motivations of war, too.
Yes.
Just going back to the question you posed, I think running through the plays is a fear of the kingdom that is divided, that is in some way fractured. That civil war was obviously one of the great fears, wasn't it, of his age? And that resounds through his plays. And I think he'd be terrified. I think Shakespeare would be appalled, truthfully, at the divisions that the current debate have opened up over the last 6 weeks. This idea of a nation, which is actually, it's an ugly mood, isn't it? It's a nation that's become a war with itself over this referendum. And whatever the result, it's going to be sort of roughly half and half, isn't it? And it's going to take years to heal those bitter divisions, I would
say. So social divisions are obviously really important to the plots. I mean, we often have the motifs of ethnicity or religious difference, as in The Merchant of Venice, race he's not afraid to deal with, and obviously class, which, although I take your point, there's no electorate, there are often people who are really dissenting from the hand that life has dealt them and the ways that authority is wielded over them, but also, of course, sex and gender and the ways in which girls challenge the authority of their fathers, the question about the ways in which women and men are constrained to kind of certain gender roles. And I think now is the time to raise the question that Glenda Jackson is going to play King Lear. And what, how, I know that you're, it's very, very early days, and I know that you don't want to be, you know, kind of put your back to the wall on this, but so far thinking about it, how are you thinking about what difference you as a female actor playing an archetypically male, masculine role, what difference is it going to make to the role, and what difference is it going to make to you, I guess, is another question. I know you're still thinking about it, and I'm sure the audience will respect that this is going to be a provisional answer.
Well, I don't know yet. I mean, that's the simple answer. But what I find interesting, I think it's interesting the way, quite deliberately and for political, I would argue, reasons, there has been a justified and justifiable attempt on the part of female actresses to break down the wall that has excluded them from playing some of the great parts. We've had, you know, the odd Hamlet and things like that. But we've had the all-female productions of the Henrys, and there's one apparently on in New York at the moment, which is The Taming of the Shrew. But my interest isn't that. I mean, I think in many ways that battle, amongst other battles, theatrically has been won. My interest is in how age, and this is entirely personal because now I'm old, how age begins to, not fray, the gender difference between old men and women is really quite small. I mean, you can see it sort of blending away in exactly the same way at the other end of the age scale, when they're very young, we teach them to be boys and girls. And I that's really what interests me. So what difference it will make to me and what difference it will make to the character, I don't know yet, because at the moment, I just don't know. I mean, you know, you don't know until you start rehearsing with the other people. But it is that difference that, you know, a man would do this or a woman would do that, it becomes far less defined the older we become, which is something that I am experiencing myself. But when I was a Member of Parliament and were dealing with constituents in a variety of situations when they were elderly, for example, say, in a long-stay nursing home, it becomes really clear that gender barrier is being rubbed away. And in some instances, it can be a painful process, but in others, it can be very liberating.
That's very, very interesting, the intersection of age and gender. But Shakespeare also has a reputation, doesn't he, of being quite an old reactionary when it comes to sex roles. So we have cross-dressing female characters who have to dress up as men in order to make their way in the world and do anything, have any agency. Or we have women who object to the power that's being wielded over them by their fathers, as with Juliet and countless other heroines. But in the end, in the comedies particularly, everything is put back in its place and the characters are paired up in nice heterosexual pairs, and that he has been read as always reasserting the proper sexual order of things.
I would slightly question your word reactionary there, because if you think about these vibrant women in Shakespeare's plays, they don't simply lie down and suffer, do they? I mean, one of their devices, as you rightly say, is to put on a male attire and go in pursuit of the man. If you compare, take As You Like It, I mean, yes, on the surface it may look like a play that's, you know, an advertisement for marriage. I remember Peter Brook once said he never wanted to direct As You Like It. He said it looked to him like an advertisement for beer. He thought there was something sort of robustly hearty about it. But it actually, in the end, it is a very powerful play, isn't it? About a woman who does take responsibility for actions, goes off to the forest, dresses as a man or a boy, and then what does she do? She starts to woo the very man she wants to have as a husband. And she has the last word in the play too, doesn't she? That famous epilogue. And you could go through all the plays, I think, and find examples.
Absolutely.
I think the problem with Romeo and Juliet is that Juliet doesn't go off to, was it Mantua? Padua. You know, you feel Shakespeare's created this vibrant character who would have gone off. She'd put on male attire and go in pursuit of him. She wouldn't wait at home, you know, for these potions to get mixed up and the postal service to ruin it all. So, I mean, and even these endings, I mean, I think one thing we probably learned, or the theatre's shown us, is how equivocal some of these endings are. Are marriages really repaired that seem to be at the end of the play? What happened at the end of The Winter's Tale, for example? You know, Leontes has behaved like a monster, hasn't he? You know, his wife has been imprisoned virtually, thought dead for 16 years. Their child has died. And what happens at the end? The statue comes to life. She does not say, I think I read saying, does she, a single word to Leontes at the end. So you can play that play as a man seeking reconciliation, but denied it by the wife. What happens at the end of Measure for Measure, famously?
Yeah,
you know, what happens? The Duke proposes to Isabella. She says not a word.
No, never answers.
I mean, nowadays, you'd be horrified if there was a production where she fell into his arms.
Yes.
No, I think Shakespeare is always, always, always much more equivocal, ambivalent, and unpindownable than one assumes.
I think that's also true with politics. So we often, at the end of a great tragedy, or at the end of the history plays, we get a sort of sense of the crown now being put on the right head, or order and good government being restored. And yet, of course, who in the audience is really going to believe that as they leave the theatre? Who's going to say, oh, well, that was good, happy ever after?
What
because everything has been...
You know, presumably, they knew the plays that came before. I mean, they knew the actual cycle of this.
Yes. But what happens these days in many productions of Hamlet that I've seen, photographs, you used to come in, it was played by a rather uninteresting actor, didn't they? You know.
You are cruel.
No, I'm not. It was your young Jude's role, wasn't it?
Well, they're not necessarily
comes on in white at the end, looking noble, etc. Nowadays, photographs tends to come on as a military thug who's replacing one corrupt regime with another corrupt regime.
Yes.
He's a power figure these days.
I think
so. All the plays, as we keep saying, are so open. They can be interpreted in so many different ways.
And the production really changes the text. So I suppose that's a question that I would like to ask about the extent to which Shakespeare in production does have any transformative effect on the text, on its meaning. Because clearly these plays can be staged in very different ways, either as asserting sovereignty and right or as undermining it, either as asserting, you know, conventional sex roles or as disrupting them. And how does that process actually work in rehearsal? Is it a matter of negotiation? Or have you normally got a director who's got a vision?
No, I mean, as I said earlier, you're lucky if you have a good director, because they always know what they don't want, so they're very effective in saying to you no. I mean, that's one of Brooke's favourite words, no. And so you don't spend pointless hours going down long avenues.
Right.
But I think what it is, well,
it is very important that you don't regard the play, whatever the play may be, as being its title. And nine times out of ten, if the title is the eponymous character, that is a trap that people can fall into very easily.
Right.
And just think, oh, well, this is just a play about one character. They're not. They're actually about all the people who are in it. But you discover by doing, and you do it by just doing it. I mean, you can... What am I trying to say here? If only I had Shakespeare. He has the capacity, if, as I've said earlier, you take as your basic premise that he wrote a play and you ignore all the received information that people are desperate to throw onto you, he is so surprising. It is so surprising that the actual, not the language, because the language is there, but the depths and the heights and the lows. I mean, he really can take you right up to some, I don't know, higher place and push you down the dirtiest sewer you can possibly imagine. And that is just an extraordinary experience. And when it happens, then you understand how it was possible for that group of actors who were working at the Globe to keep a rambunctious audience surrounded by noise. I mean, the theatre was in one of the noisiest parts of London, you know, with their pockets being picked and people eating and one thing and another. And to keep them quiet, to be able to hear it, it was just, you know, it's just amazing. Mm. But it is, you have to be both humble and extraordinarily arrogant, I think, if you do a Shakespeare play. Really, and it's that kind of dichotomy.
Does anybody have any questions, either about sexual politics in Shakespeare or about this question of the way production seem to offer us new readings? There's a lady in the... Hi, thank you.
I'm aware of discussions about gender-free Shakespeare.
Yeah.
The Magistrate Exchange production of Hamlet, a female delivered Hamlet words, not male Hamlet, and yet at the Donmark, the all-female production was females speaking male lines.
Mm.
And that was my experience of two. And comments, is Shakespeare's language gender-free?
But was that because of the subjects of the play? I mean, you're talking about Hamlet, I presume the Maxine Peake, wasn't it? And the other was the Henry IV, was it? Well, obviously the one is very militaristic, so there is a kind of, I would have thought, I didn't see it, and I didn't see Maxine's Hamlet, but there is a difference in the characters as well as the structure of the play. And is there? I don't think so. I don't think there is, no.
But
you don't think that it's gendered?
Well, in gendered, no, I don't. I mean, I'm thinking, no, I don't think so. I mean, there may be overt differences in that some of the women may be given slightly flowery, more flowery words to say. Even as I'm saying this, I'm disagreeing with myself,
okay,
because some of the most wonderful, beautiful, flowery words are put into men's mouths. No, I don't think. I think again, it's the inside that he is so closely attuned to, and what comes out is part of that inner energy.
Mm.
I just think of the examples you chose. I mean, they're very different productions, weren't they? Because the Hamlet, I mean, A, there's a long tradition of women playing Hamlet, but in that production of all sorts of gender confusion. So Polonius, if I remember correctly, became Polonia. But then why not? You know, why couldn't you have a top civil servant, you know, who was a woman and prone to whatever Polonius is prone to?
Going on and on.
Yes. You know, but the point of that production, I mean, it was, the genders were deliberately confused, if you like. The point about the Donmar Shakespeare's, which Phyllida Lloyd has done, is that she seems to be finding a context, a reason why. The first one she did, I think, was Julius Caesar, and it was done in a women's prison.
Yeah.
And therefore, these women were putting on Julius Caesar as a way of retaliating against the sort of cruel, you know, prison regime. Yeah. So, I mean, it's horses for courses, and there are different ways of approaching it. What is fascinating, though, is, use the word gender-free, I mean, how every company is now exploring this as a possibility. And showing that you can mix it up. And in Cymbeline at Stratford this year, Cymbeline, the title role, is a woman. And it does actually make a very interesting difference to the play to have that.
So I suppose I'm interested in what difference does it make?
Well, it for starts, Cymbeline played by a woman, and in the original, if you like, Cymbeline's a man married to a wicked woman who's contriving against Imogen. In this version, Cymbeline is a woman married to a rather oppressed, henpecked man in a way, whom she is manipulating. It just gives her more agency to use your word
right, earlier, right.
And made the king, now the queen, a much more pivotal figure in the production than it normally is.
Yeah.
It's hard to explain exactly what difference it makes. But it does alter the power structure within the play.
Which is different from saying that it's gender neutral, or that, you know, we go back to Shakespeare, the great humanist who transcends all of our identifications, whether they're racial, religious, or sex. There's a lady with a pink scarf. You have to please wait for the mic, otherwise people won't hear you.
So any minute when I speak, everyone says, "Where are you from?" Which I hate.
Okay, anyway, we won't ask.
Yes, and so I shall say, I'm a Can-American. I come from both Canada and America. And I ask this question of you all. Do you sort of remember, in a way, that when Shakespeare wrote his plays, that they were all acted by men, that there were no women on stage at that period of time? And we sort of, this conversation seems to have forgotten that. And I think that that is an absolutely major thing that we all need to think about. And it's not so much a question, then it's like, duh, did you not remember that? And I say that because it's more my American part than my Canadian part that says this. And I also would like to ask a question of Glenda, who just inspires me, that, and you, Michael, because you're so brilliant as well, but Glenda, I think...
Thanks.
Yeah, the question is this. Glenda, I think that people think that when women age, they become masculinized. I can't say that properly. But do you feel that about yourself? And does that make it easier?
Well, we don't
for
say
you
that in this country. What we say in this country, which. I mean, we are deemed to be marvellous that we can put one foot in front of another. When we reach the heady age of 65. And so, no, I think there's a strong element of hypocrisy with regard to age, not exclusively in our country, and I think it is something in the Western world, which is completely different to the Eastern world, where age is actually respected and revered. And in a very interesting way, and there isn't that division, I think, with gender. But to go back to your point about everybody who appeared in Shakespeare was male, no, of course we haven't forgotten that. What we have to remember is that the differential between male and female in his plays is marked. Mm. You know that it's a woman speaking, and you know it's a man that's speaking in many of his plays. But to go back to a point that you made earlier about, you know, the gender thing, he is completely non-protective of the popular image of women in his day. Yeah. The insults to women are there, the derogation of them, the dismissal of them. I mean, he absolutely represents what were the prevailing political, if you like, views about women, while never writing women in those particular boxes, which is amazing.
Yes, He is extraordinarily sort of, he's a ventriloquist, isn't he? Absolutely. I mean, he can move voices around. Absolutely. And everything is always multivocal. So at the same time that he is recycling these commonplaces, yeah, he's also questioning them and undermining them.
Well, yes, subverts orthodoxies. Mm-hmm. I mean, the two trickiest plays from modern audience are The Taming of the Shrew, aren't they, and The Merchant of Venice, and how, but there was problem, how to get around them. But it's extraordinary how in performance the problems seem to dissolve in different ways. Yeah. So Kate's notorious speech, toxic speech at the end of The Taming of the Shrew, mm, can acquire all kinds of things. Irony, for example. Yes. Is it her way of belittling Petruchio, yeah, by saying, well, if you want me, I'll put my hand, you know, beneath your foot. I mean, what a way to humiliate a man to say that in front of him. Merchant of Venice, I mean, goodness knows, I mean, there's endless ways of exploring
the Jewish Christian relationship.
Yes, and Shakespeare seems to create a stereotype and then proceeds to subvert it as the play proceeds, doesn't he? Mm-hmm. Making Shylock initially an epitome of the usurer, by the end a wholly tragic and persecuted figure.
Yes.
So, yeah.
And in the middle, the great humanist speech of "Have not a Jew eyes," which totally transcends any kind of social conflict.
I mean, we use the word transcendent, don't we? Like,
well, I do. Sorry,
yeah, I mean, no, we all do. No, we all do. But I mean, another word might be slippery. You know.
Okay. Good.
It's very hard, isn't it, Shakespeare? Like an eel. It's very hard to actually.
But he's amazingly open-minded, isn't he? I mean, to go back, he's never judgmental about his characters. But I mean, talking about the gender and the sexual mores of the day, he's completely without any sense of being judgmental. I mean, there are people who, you know, are within his plays extremely judgmental about any kind of variation on what is deemed by the society of the day to be acceptable sexual practice, whereas every sexual practice is in Shakespeare somewhere.
Yes.
I mean, it's not as though he doesn't know what's going on.
No.
And I just find that marvellous as well.
Absolutely.
Do you think, Michael Billington, it's the same with his attitudes to the market and money and the new relationships of exchange and the new freedoms? I mean, he himself was described as an upstart crow by, you're going to tell me who it was, a
Green,
critic
Robert
of
Green.
Green, who said, who is this guy? You know, he's a nobody, small learning, little Greek.
And then he goes and what does he do? He's got some money, he goes and buys the biggest house he has, property.
In Stratford.
Yes. A bourgeois property owner.
And absolutely. Yet, in many of the plays, he again sort of casts aspersion on the way in which now everything's for sale and if people know the price of everything and the value of nothing and so on and so forth.
The Merchant of Venice is the supreme play about money, isn't it? I mean, it's not, I think personally, a play simply about race and religion. It's a play about the operation of money because money runs through every scene. It's about money that's being lent, it's being money that's being borrowed, it's about money that's being gambled on, the irresponsibility of using other people's money to further your own ends. What does Bassanio do? Mm. I mean, Bassanio actually is the one who's really triggering the whole thing, isn't he? Because he needs money to finance his expedition to Belmont to woo this
very
lady.
Very rich woman.
What is Portia? She's the prisoner of money in a way, isn't she? She's the prisoner of her father's inheritance and this absurd game that he's concocted for her. So, money, it seems to me, she understands the operation of money. Shylock has a wonderful speech, which is not often noted, I think, towards the end, when he says when he's on trial, when he's in the court, he says, you've got to give me justice, because if you don't, there is no force in the decrees of Venice. His point is that Venice is a huge global trading point, isn't it? Its reputation in the world depends upon this.
Yeah.
And if they deny him justice, they will then besmirch their own reputation. It's a very subtle argument, actually, which he's using, you know, to win his case.
There's a variation of that in Othello as well, isn't there?
Yes, with the Argo.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
The Argo counts everything in money terms.
Yes, I mean, whatever Shakespeare's personal desire to. And why shouldn't he earn a bob or two? You know, my God, after those plays, he was entitled when he earned. I was. When I look at that house in Stratford, or the relic of it, I think, yes, why not? You know. But at the same time, he understood money and again the corrupting
power. The corrupting power of money, but also, of course, the corrupting power of, you know, the older relationships, which were based on status and, of course, kingship.
But I mean, of Athens, not a play that people used to do, but again, it's being done more often.
It's being done more often, isn't it? It's certainly coming back.
And what's that show that actually Timon is only... He is a tragic figure. He thinks you can purchase friendship.
Doesn't yes.
He thinks if you give people enough in the way of dinners and yes. presents and gifts, you will then purchase their love and goodwill. He finds to his horror and chagrin that it's not true. But it's also about the cruelty of the people who desert him the moment they realise he
yes.
has a penny to his name.
That they see no social obligation to him.
Right. And so that's it's not a great play, but it's a powerful play about the operation of money.
It's an extremely powerful play, and it's got that rather marvellous metaphor where he he's digging in the ground and he finds gold.
Yes.
And it's all very hellish.
This Marx's speech, doesn't he? About
and in fact, Marx does footnote Timon in
that's right.
the Capital.
So Shakespeare yeah. was a Marxist, Michael Pollan.
Yeah, Marx was a Shakespearean.
I went on off the director once said to me, he said, of course, Michael, you know Shakespeare was a Marxist.
Well, Brecht, I assume, thought that Shakespeare was a Marxist. I mean, Brecht did Coriolanus.
He did. Well, he made Shakespeare Marxist.
He made Shakespeare Marxist, but you can certainly read Coriolanus as being about class conflict. Not about, as it were, the electorate, but about the proletariat. And I think that Brecht...
He did a version of it.
Is it?
Yes, I mean, he wrote, well, I'm stepping out of my comfort zone here, but I think he wrote his own version of it.
He did, didn't he? Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, right, he didn't stick to the text.
The plot.
He shifted. But directors do, right?
Oh, yes.
You have to cut it. I mean, Shakespeare takes 5 hours, doesn't it, if you do the whole thing, so... But you have to.
It doesn't have to be.
You can do it quicker.
Yeah. But going back to.
You can actually.
Going back to Coriolanus, what Brecht, I think I might say, was he wanted to make the play about the danger of the state that depends upon a hero, you know.
Right.
And that was what he wanted to prove. Yeah. But we haven't mentioned Coriolanus so far. No. It's a fascinating play because that was a play which, in the 1930s, I think I'm right in saying, the Nazis appropriated. As a demonstration of the power of Führer. They used the word Führer to describe Coriolanus. 3 years later, that was 1935, I think there was a famous Nazi version of it, sanctioned by Goebbels. 3 years later, Laurence Olivier was in a production in London and portrayed Coriolanus as Mussolini, in other words, a dangerous fascist. So again, Coriolanus becomes whatever the society needs him to be at that moment.
Yeah, and Rafe Fiennes recent?
He played him as a sort of military...
Yeah, as the military, it was set in sort of Serbia, wasn't it?
That's right,
it?
Yes,
it
in the Civil War.
That's
film, a great play, because it constantly shifts its ground, I think.
So there is a question, really. Why, you know, why is it Shakespeare of all writers who is in this way endlessly reinterpretable, endlessly restageable, endlessly... You can put his plays on to show the evils of fascism or the evils of capitalism or the evils of feminism. You know, you can have almost anybody in your sights. And I think people ask this question and throw up their hands and say, well, we don't know, you've got me. But have you got an answer to that? What makes him particularly plastic? In this
right.
sense.
Well, I haven't got a ready answer, if only I had.
No.
But just going back to your question, I mean, it has struck me down the years how everyone appropriates Shakespeare. I said, you know, different countries find different meanings here, but also individuals, I've noticed. And I did quote one. Michael Bogdanov seriously said to me Shakespeare was a Marxist, but I've known others say that Shakespeare was a Catholic. I mean, that's a very common line.
Yeah.
The missing years, you know, we can't account for, oh, Catholics were so he was obviously involved in Lancashire where he was teaching in a Catholic household, etc.
Exactly. No,
was he gay? Was he gay? Was he straight? You know?
Did he write the plays?
Yes.
Ludicrous.
Let's not go down.
That one, no.
Let's
come back.
But I mean, sexuality, gay or straight, yeah. You know, and you can prove either, really, depending on which aspect of the plays you want to look at, which bit of the sonnets you want to look at.
Yeah, absolutely.
So maybe that's one answer to your question, actually. That because everyone can kind of stake a claim to Shakespeare, I mean, Tories can claim, going back to that opening question, you know, remain or leave, Tories will always claim Shakespeare was one of ours, and they will always quote the same speeches. They'll always quote John of Gaunt and Richard II, you know, the Sectadal, and then always quote the degree speech in Troilus and Cressida, saying, oh, Shakespeare believed in the class system. But then sensible liberals will look at other plays and find equally contradictory speeches. Mm. And it's this thing, someone once said, I forget who, Shakespeare wasn't left-wing, he wasn't right-wing, he was wing-less. And I think there's something in that, actually.
Well,
and that's part of the greatness, and it's this comprehension of human nature and human and society that makes the play so extraordinary. Yeah. And you don't find that in Ben Jonson, let's say, wonderful as Ben Jonson is, or wonderful as Christopher Marlowe is. No. You don't find that, I don't know.
You don't find it in people subsequently either.
You don't
find it in the 20th century political playwrights.
I mean, that's why we love Chekhov, I suppose. Right. Well, I'm not saying Chekhov is by Chekhov, but it's why we love Chekhov. It's that non-judgmental quality, isn't it?
And arguably, that is the nub of the political nature of Shakespeare, that it's open.
Yes.
That we believe, if we're going to try to do things politically, that they could be different. We might not be starry-eyed optimists, but the idea is that we can keep plugging away, and between us can make a difference out of these very, very different perspectives and voices, and that's a...
Is that true? I mean, doesn't he really only ever ask three questions?
What are they?
Who are we, what are we, why are we?
Oh, well.
Isn't that... another bit, really? And are they not really the only important questions we should all ask ourselves all the time and never come up with an answer? But they're the imponderables, aren't they?
They're the imponderables. Okay, so now people in the audience do want... I think that's a very good... Because, you know, you've got me. So that's a good place to bring the audience in. There's a question here. Yeah, hi. The mic's just coming to you. Anybody else?
Actually,
wave for arms. Okay, thank you.
I have an answer for this question.
Oh, good. Good.
Yeah. I'm actually from Iran, and we have a great, great poet. His name is Hafiz. And Hafiz has got only one book of poetry, but anyone reads the same poet, for instance, poet number one, poem number one, they get the thing they want. As Mercutio says in Romeo and Juliet, when we reach to that party, each one seeks what he or she wants. I mean, what he wants, actually. So I think when we read Shakespeare, we have our own interpretation. That's why everyone finds something that he or she is looking for.
Mm.
And there's always an answer in each play that we read. Mm. Because of that, Shakespeare is not English, and Shakespeare is not, Shakespeare belongs to the world, and what he wrote was universal, even at that time.
And do you think that Hafiz has the same?
Hafiz
is the same explanation.
Yeah, but he was
but
he was 400 years before Shakespeare. But this is actually, you can find your answer, and we. I don't know what's the word in English. For instance, when you have coffee, then you can look at
read the grounds, read the tea leaves.
Okay, we actually open the book. We just think of something, and we open the book to see if we are going to be successful or not in the book of Hafiz. And it's 800 years that Iranians are doing this. They when they want to do something. Maybe it's a little bit, you know.
Thank you very much. There was a question over here. So you've got to leg it. So there's a mic coming down on your left behind you.
Thank you.
Hi.
I wanted to ask Glenda a question about the relationship between Shakespeare, power, and mental health. And, you know, if we look at his depiction of Lear's madness as the ultimate lusts of a political state of the mind, in contrast, say, to the theatricality of madness in Hamlet or other incidences in his canon of where we today might use a blanket term of madness. How far do you think his understanding was of the
madness? I have great difficulty with the word mad.
Yeah.
Because it means something entirely different today. You know, I mean, we all say, oh, you're driving me mad. I mean, we just stop doing that. It's driving, that noise is driving me mad. We don't mean we are actually going into whatever the medical definition of madness or insanity would be. And I don't think that is what is meant in the play. But what is interesting now in our time is that people are now talking about dementia as being sorry, the central heating. Excuse me. I'd finished.
Okay, sorry. Hanging on your every word. Is there another question? Yes, at the back in the middle, and then I also think there's one on the aisle. There. Can you wave your hand?
There's a lady on the aisle.
Man in the shirt, and then there's somebody on the aisle as well.
I'm going up to get some
food.
That's awful, though.
Can we have some assistance, please? Thanks. Thanks very much.
It is difficult in here.
Once you start, it's extremely difficult to master that. Okay, so sorry, please.
I'm sorry. The question wasn't all that difficult, so she didn't have to leave. But I was just wondering, I used to be an English teacher and had to teach Shakespeare a number of plays to children in a school in West London where there was 72 different languages being spoken, and they found it incredibly difficult to access the plays, as, you know, I think we'd all admit, all have at some point. And I was just wondering how important you think it is that Shakespeare is taught in the original language. Because there is an argument to say, as with, for instance, the Baz Luhrmann production of Romeo and Juliet, children find that much more exciting and accessible, but something may be lost of the original meaning in the translation in order to convey the meaning that you assume. And so I just wondered, in teaching Shakespeare, how important do you think it is that we retain the original language?
And this also raises the question of translation.
It does.
And yours, and indeed Glenda's experience of watching Shakespeare in a foreign language.
Yes.
I suppose wondering what's added as well as what's lost in translation.
I mean, it seems to be a lot depends on circumstance. You were talking about teaching in a multi-ethnic school, obviously, where you're faced with students with lots of, presumably lots of different languages, English only one of them. What do you do? I would have thought, ideally, you start with Shakespeare in English, don't you? Peter Brook, whose name keeps coming up because Glenda's worked with him and I met him on often. He was here in the library last week, I think, actually. Peter Brook, who's worked, you know, on Shakespeare in other languages, primarily French, all his life, always pines, I know this, to get back to Shakespeare in English, because he feels, however sophisticated the translation, however beautiful it is, there is some fundamental element, you know, that it goes missing whenever you put the plays into other languages. Having said that, it seems to me, you know, living in the real world, it is vital that Shakespeare is translated into everything from Japanese to Swahili to, you know, German to Russian to whatever. And I've seen lots of examples of Shakespeare in other languages. And what happens, I find, is the plays can sometimes be liberated when you take them away from the English language. I mean, the English language is both a glory and a prison, actually. I don't need to emphasize the glory, but the prison is that, you know, we are confined by those words on that page. And I've seen fantastic Shakespeare productions. Many of you will have seen the productions of a man called Ninagawa, a great Japanese director who died only recently. Yukio Ninagawa, his productions came to England a lot. And I've never forgotten a famous Macbeth he did in Japanese, in a samurai culture. And what was the abiding image? It was of cherry blossom, cascading cherry blossom. And Macbeth, which is a play that we think of in terms of darkness, gloom, you know, crepuscular settings, shadowy castles, in Japanese, in that production, became a play bathed in light and filled with physical beauty. And when I inquired about this, I was told, well, in Japan, the cherry blossom is a symbol of transience, mortality, of death, but it's also something of extraordinary beauty. So I mean, that's just a tiny example of how you can see Shakespeare in other languages and learn something. Shakespeare's Globe did a season many of you will have seen about 2 years ago when they did all 37 plays, you know, in productions from other cultures. Not all the productions were fantastic, but some of them were eye-opening, actually, because they gave us a fresh perspective. So there's no easy answer to your question, except to say that in an ideal world, yes, you start with the English language, but there's fun and exploration in doing him in other languages.
But Shakespeare's particular version of the English language is tough, isn't it, for ESL children?
Yes, of course
it is. Because the puns, the play on words, the some archaic vocabulary.
It's tough, I think.
Is, you know, it's tough for all of
it's
us.
It's tough for all of us, yes, and there are always it's later plays, the language is so compacted, isn't it? Mm. You have to sort of disentangle it, or unknot it.
Lots of words.
At other times, though, Shakespeare, I don't know, has this extraordinary capacity, even if you're not getting all the meaning, to seize the imagination. Absolutely. And, I mean, he's very good, I think, at opening plays. There's never been a better opening to a play than Who's There?
Yeah.
What a way to start a play. Immediately your interest is aroused. It's made more interesting, sorry, just to finish that, by the obvious fact that you expect the person on guard to say, who's there? And what does he do? It's the person coming up on duty who says, who's there? So there's a reversal of the natural order of things, and only two words have been spoken.
Yeah, already. It's upside down. Okay, so there was a lady on the aisle, thank you very much, and then after you, that we've got somebody on my left here. Thank you.
Well, because people did rewrite Shakespeare in the 18th century, Colley Cibber rewrote it, and made Cordelia come back to life at the end.
Sure.
And they didn't do Lear when George III was thought to be mad because it was thought to be tasteless. And we've talked a lot, very interestingly, I think, about the plays that we favour now. I wonder what we might learn about ourselves from the plays that are out of favour now.
What do you mean out of favour now? Why are they out of favour? Are they out of favour because they're too expensive to stage? Because actors don't want to do them? Because directors don't want to direct them? You have to say which plays we don't favour so we can actually examine ourselves as to why we don't favour them. She said being bossy.
Perhaps out of favour was the wrong phrase, but I think I was very interested by what Michael said about how the history plays have enjoyed a great renaissance. And I'm just interested to know, as not a critic and not an actor, so I don't know exactly what's being done, what in the repertoire is less common at the moment. I don't think cost is ever an argument, because you can always do a play if you want to.
Well, I think there are certain plays that will always be marginal. I think King John will always be an unloved bastard play, you know. People would do it occasionally out of duty, but no one does it, as far as I know, with love. Two Gentlemen of Verona struggles, it seems to me, to get into the visual free, you know, quite honestly. It's not a bad play, it's of interest to Shakespeare students, but it's not a sort of compelling play. So I think there are certain plays that will always be somewhat marginal. All's Well That Ends Well, I think, is a play that people sort of wrestle with. It's not, in my experience, ever become a sort of box office cert. But my argument is, and I fell out with the RSC of this, I said that their trouble was they were narrowing Shakespeare down to the 12 box office certs.
Right.
So every season, that they either Midsummer's Dream or Hamlet or, you know, one of the guaranteed box office certs. And I said, your duty, again, being bossy, is to say, you've got to do all the plays. And to his great credit, Greg Doran is now working his way through the whole 37 cycle. So each play comes up once every 6 years.
But also the educational landscape has changed. When I was a schoolgirl, there was always a set Shakespearean play for whichever exam you were doing in whichever stage of your development, to which you were taken. And every repertory company in the country did that play.
Mm.
because they had the schools in the area going to see it. Mm. That has gone. Mm. We don't have that anymore. And the idea of teaching Shakespeare to children by letting them actually see a play or even do the play themselves seems to have gone out the window.
It's a very good point, actually, I mean, you make it, because regional theatres now are doing less and less Shakespeare.
Absolutely.
I mean, you get Shakespeare, obviously, at Stratford, at the Globe, yeah. But and sometimes, you know, these NT Lives. But if you look at the average
absolutely.
Regional theatre, unless it's Manchester, one of the big ones, is doing yes. hardly any Shakespeare now for cost reasons.
We've got one last question. Can you wave your hand? Yes, here you are. And then I think we need to wrap up.
Thank you. It's been wonderful. Both of you, all three of you. Sorry, I just had to ask about what it seems I'm hearing in a way. You know, is the need to avoid the museumization of Shakespeare. And with all the liveliness that's in the plays, that lives in them, and this question about language and the originality, the original texts, etc., well, original through the folios, you know, it makes me think about Bach or Beethoven or any of these, the great three Bs, right? So we can't hear them now in this time with the ears that 17th century, 18th century people would have heard, right? So how can we hear Shakespeare actually the same way? Just being accustomed to traffic and the tube and conversation in an auditorium like this and so on. So we haven't got those ears. We're not in London of that time, in the London of that time. And so, and we're not living under the monarchs of those times either. So we adapt as the plays adapt, right? And the plays adapt as we adapt, etc. I'm just kind of wrestling with this question. It's more of a, I'm not sure if it's a question, but just sort of thinking about the, not wanting to make Shakespeare's works into these very valorized museums, and looking at the liveliness in them, right? And thinking about also keeping them at the populist level, making sure that people really do experience them on a day-to-day basis, if at all possible. I'm not sure that's really... Because they're seen so much as high art, right? That's one of the things that we grapple with now in the UK, I think, and elsewhere.
Thank you very much. In fact, I think that's a brilliant final question to consider, really. So we've assumed that, as it were, Shakespeare speaks to all of us,
yes.
and we can always find meaning and indeed political as well as ethical and poetic and other forms of meaning in the plays. The question is how, I suppose there are two questions. You know, how is it that it has that quality, which is a question that we have wrestled with, but also how do we keep that and not let him become a museum piece? Perhaps Michael first.
Well, I mean, it's a very interesting question. I think the first point you made about the language, I mean, heaven forbid that we would try to recreate the sound of Shakespeare to an Elizabethan ear, because from all the scholars I've ever encountered, it would sound very strange and rather like a sort of bad rustic accent, I mean, today, wouldn't it? If you tried to recreate Elizabethan speech pattern. So let's not do that. That would be museum Shakespeare, I think. I think the answer to the question is we keep him fresh by reinventing him. And when you go, for example, to Shakespeare's Globe, I mean, today, that is, you know, you'll see an extraordinarily wide-ranging audience, often made up of, you know, tourists who are there because it's on their itinerary, a lot of people who are passionate about the plays. I'm always struck by the mixed nature of that audience, the multi-ethnicity of that audience, and the speed with which they cotton on to all the references in Shakespeare. They're a very attentive audience, actually. I think occasionally, this is my beef, the actors, I think, patronise them or play down to them or overfeed them. But at the same time, I'm very impressed by the alertness of that audience and how these plays, which can be difficult, become accessible. It depends on the quality of the productions. Mm-hmm. If the acting is as exciting as we want it to be, the productions are good, these plays will have no problems getting across.
Yeah. Okay, so Glenda Jackson, the last...
Well, I thought the initial part of the question was going to be that the language of Shakespeare versus the music of Bach, and why was the one easily... But you didn't make that contrast. You were saying they were both at different times, and we have different ears, certainly for the music, and different ears for the... For me, the really interesting thing about that is that music has always seemed to me to be set, whereas words are so ambiguous and are so
you said, what was it, not snaky about Shakespeare?
Slippery.
Slippery.
I mean, open to interpretation. Thousand million ways. I mean, some, you know, you said, who's there? You know, what a marvellous opener for a play. To quote from my own direct experience, there are he words, me girls, he words, me. There are seven lines in Antony and Cleopatra, seven words in the play Antony and Cleopatra, which contain the whole of Cleopatra's character. And you can say those seven words a thousand different ways, and they will always be essentially what she's about. And she says, he words me, girls, he words me. Now you can say that, you know, and I did, I mean, depending on how the play was playing. But it is that incredible, well, ambiguity is a pointless word to use. It is the endless richness of, and the simplicity. I mean, we all know the cliche, you know, simplicity is very complicated. But it's true. And to go back to what I said much, much earlier, he is so non-judgmental. He not only was brilliant with a quill pen, his ears were attuned not just to what people say, but what they don't say. And that's just staggering, actually, staggering.
Thank you. Thank you both very, very much. And thanks to the audience for some brilliant, stimulating questions, to the British Library for having us, to the Political Studies Association.